Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt this program to bring you a bulletin from WCBS Radio News. The story, as it is just being handed to me, is datelined Dallas, Texas. It says, according to the United Press, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade today in downtown Dallas. The incident occurred near the county sheriff's office on Main Street, just east of an underpass, leading toward the trademark. The trademark.
Good morning, everyone. Talk Radio 930 WTAD, heading into the Veterans Day Parade, which is going to be held on November 8th this year in Quincy. And we have the Parade Grand Marshal with us, Richard Pace, who lives over in Canton, Missouri, played a very important part in history. He was a witness to history. He was in the funeral procession of John F. Kennedy. Now, if you remember where you were in November of 1963, I don't think anyone who's alive today will forget where they were when they heard this on WTAD Radio.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States is dead. John F. Kennedy has died of the wounds received in an assassination in Dallas less than an hour ago. We repeat, it has just been announced that President Kennedy is dead.
That was the scene in November of 1963, and my guest, Richard Pace, was a young man at that time, and he's still a young man. And where were you when you first heard that John F. Kennedy had been assassinated, sir?
At the time, I was stationed at Fort Myer, Virginia, with the old guard, and we were on the north end of the post exercising horses. We got to receive some word that we was to report back to our section, and when we got back to the section, that's when we got the information that the president had been assassinated.
I'm sure that was a very emotional time for you.
I think it was quite an emotional time for everyone involved in it, not just me or, you know, and all the members of the military, since he was our commander-in-chief.
Now, you had already been assigned and were probably working on funeral details of fallen military soldiers. So is that what your assignment was, to help be part of the honor guard for every serviceman or woman who was laid to rest?
The caisson section primarily pulled only full honor funerals. We'd have one funeral a day, sometimes up to five funerals a day in Arlington. They were all full honor funerals, normally in the rank of colonel or above, heads of state, specially recognized enlisted personnel of that nature. I think in the time I was there, if I'm not mistaken, I think the section performed around 1,300 funerals in Arlington.
It's amazing. And so you provided dignity to every person that was laid to rest with those full military honors, and you certainly were prepared. We're all aware that that unit is very, you know, an honorable unit. They try to treat everybody with dignity and respect. And I'm sure you're always prepared to have the funeral of perhaps some ranking official who passes away of older age, but it must have come as quite a shock to realize that now you are going to be in the funeral procession for the fallen president. When did you actually get the word, Richard Pace, that you were going to be in the caisson?
It was the day before we were to go to pick up the casket at the White House and take it to the Capitol building at the into lay in state at the rotunda. And it was a day prior to that that I got the word that I would be riding the lead horse on the caisson.
So folks, if you remember the iconic pictures of John F. Kennedy's funeral, and they certainly are replayed over and over every November, Richard Pace is the gentleman sitting on the very first horse on the left in the that's pulling the caisson, carrying the president's casket. That's you on the lead horse.
That is true. I rode the lead horse on the caisson, and there were other members with the caisson section there, my chief of section, Thomas Sitterberg, who was out of the state of Minnesota, my swing man, that was the middle rider, Charles Wade was his name, and I believe he was from Kentucky, but I'm not going to swear to that. No, correction, it was Jim Simpson was the swing rider, and Charles Wade was the wheel horse who controlled the brake on the caisson.
So he helped, when the caisson was going down the hill, he helped to make sure that the caisson didn't overpower the horses.
When needed, he had his right, he rode that brake.
He rode when the needed. Yeah. And you probably had to urge him on a little bit when they were pulling up, up a hill.
Well, those horses had pulled so many ceremonies and so many different occasions in and around Arlington, Virginia, that they didn't need any encouragement. They didn't need the prompting or anything. They knew what they were doing. They'd been at it longer than I had.
Well, that brings up an interesting question, though, because while these horses were very used to pulling military funerals on the grounds of Arlington, they were not used to the throngs of people from the U.S. Capitol all the way to Arlington, because that funeral procession went through Washington, D.C. and out to Arlington National Cemetery. And so, do you think the horses knew something extra special was going on?
I'm not sure that they did. I know the chief of sections, horse that he was riding, the horse's name was Big Boy, and I think he was excited. He pranced a lot. He was an older horse. He ended up being put down. He was retired out to, I believe it was with the University of Maryland, their veterinary school out there. And that pounding on that concrete or asphalt that distance kind of messed him up. He went lame. Now, Blackjack, that was a different story. He always walked like that. He was up on his toes all the time. That was the comparison horse that Arthur A. Carlson was leading.
The riderless horse.
The one riderless
with
horse, Roger.
The boot in backward to show someone fallen. Fallen warrior, and of course the President of the United States being the Commander-in-Chief, mm-hmm. and when he was assassinated, he was a fallen warrior. What was your horse's name?
Tell you the truth, I don't remember.
You don't remember.
I rode that horse a lot, though. That was the horse I normally rode when I performed ceremonies.
So, in some respects, this was routine for the horses. It was routine for you in some respects, but obviously nothing compared to the funeral procession of a president of the United States. Obviously, the slaying of our president was an emotional thing for every American. How did you keep your emotions in check, Richard Pace, when you're riding along there? Of course, you've got your mind on your duty, but how did you keep your emotions in check when you see people sobbing and wailing on the sidelines at this terribly grievous occasion?
I think that what I remember mostly about the procession itself was the silence of that crowd. I didn't notice anybody, you know, being overly emotional. You know, you're supposed to be riding at the position of attention, with head and eyes straight to the front. You're not looking all around. What I do remember is the occasional drum roll, the drum beat, the sound of the wheels on that pavement, and the horse's hooves, that the metal on the pavement, and rest of it, it was a blur to me. I just head and eyes to the front, and position of attention.
So your duty helped you keep yourself in check.
Well, it was.
It was what you were trying
to do. I think that one was more a show of respect and honor than. Wasn't there to have a good time.
Let's talk a little bit about the length of that funeral procession, because while you participated in many funeral processions inside Arlington, for example, this was quite a long haul for the horses, for the equipment, and for the entire funeral procession. So where did you start? And obviously you finished at Arlington, but take us through that day.
Well, we started from the stables at Fort Myer, Virginia. I don't remember exactly what time we departed the stables on the first day to go to the White House to pick up that casket and take it to the Capitol building. And it was a ride. It was a long ride. I don't know the miles.
But were you on horseback at that time? Or they were trailer?
Riding the horses.
You were riding the horses?
We did not trailer. We rode the horses from Fort Myer, Virginia to the Capitol.
To the White House.
To the White House, and then to the Capitol building when he laid in state. And then for the funeral itself, we departed very early in the morning. I don't remember exactly what time it was, but we were supposed to be in position at the Capitol building to receive the casket not later than 0900, which is 9 o'clock in the morning. And rode. We rode all the way there. We got off the horses for a few minutes after we arrived at the Capitol building. Maybe 15 minutes.
To give them a break, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm going to give us a break, too. But we got back on the horses when we were motioned or signaled to move into position to receive the casket. And that was about 9:30 in the morning. Right. We did not get off of those horses again until we got back to Arlington National Cemetery and back to our section, which was after 5 o'clock in the evening. Okay. And it was a very, very long day.
Let's go back to that funeral day. You mentioned you got up, you know, at the crack of dawn. Of course, the horses are in impeccable physical condition. Their coats are all shiny and clean. Their tack, everything about it is just in 100% condition. And you literally ride the horses from your barracks there in Virginia mm-hmm. to the White House. You get the casket the day before, and then you put it in the Capitol. So the day of the funeral, you're at the Capitol. And this is several miles long. We've determined, our associate Mike Moyer said it was about 3 miles between the Capitol and Arlington. I swear it looks like it's a lot longer than that, but again, that's D.C.
It
traffic,
felt like
I
it
guess.
It felt like it was a lot longer.
It felt like it was a lot longer, I'm very sure. So on that day, you mentioned the crowd was kind of muffled and people were very somber. When you got into the grounds of Arlington Cemetery, you pull up to the burial site. Then what do you do as the mounted horseman? What happens then? I mean, obviously the pallbearers take the casket off. Then what happens?
Well, once the casket is removed from the caisson itself and the pallbearers get far enough away from the caisson where we don't interfere with them, all right, then we leave gravesite. And we go back to our section, back to the stables, and that's
so
about it.
You were not then witnessing to the actual interment of the president or any of the activities that went on graveside because your job was to deliver the funeral casket of John F. Kennedy, and once that job was over, then your funeral detail left.
The one thing I do remember about after we left the gravesite and the taps, they always play taps at a military funeral. And that was one of the few occasions where I did have a tear in my eyes. I did have tears in my eyes.
Yeah. Okay. I think TAPS brings that out in a lot of people.
Yeah.
Did you get immune to the emotions of a funeral because you witnessed so many of them? I mean, you mentioned that not you personally, but that your unit did about 1,300 funerals. You'd sometimes do more than one a day. Was there a certain emotional immunity that built up?
I would have to say yes, that there is. If there's some article that comes out in reference to the particular funeral that you may be participating in, then you might go a little more out of the way, put a little more effort into it, just to show the proper respect to the ceremony or the funeral that you're doing for that particular individual. But it was... like so many things that you do in the military service, you know, it's your job, and you do it over and over, and you learn by repetition, and you do it repetition.
In a sense, I guess, although the president is much more famous, much more distinguished in some ways, in a sense, no different than anybody else who deserves to be buried at Arlington Cemetery. They all deserve the tack to be completely spotless, the caisson to be beautiful, you to be riding at attention. So in a way, while this was definitely a unique moment in history, as you mentioned earlier, in some aspects of it, it was just routine for you.
It is routine, but we perform services for all five branches of the service, military. I will say that there's one branch of the service that I didn't dread it, but didn't look forward to performing their ceremonies.
Now, why is that? And what is that?
It's called the the death march or death walk. It's a half step from the time you receive the casket all the way to the gravesite, and that's the U.S. Air Force. They half step all the way and try to hold those horses at a half step.
It's hard.
It's a chore.
Well, that's the other thing. You know, in a parade march, mm-hmm. a horse can walk much more quickly than a human, and yet, obviously, you had to always be restraining these horses to keep with the funeral procession, because were some members of the Kennedy family, they were walking, weren't they?
They were behind us. I don't really know what they were doing. I don't know if they walked the entire route or if they rode part and walked part. I do not know.
I just think I remember
seeing the pictures that I see are they were on foot. They were walking.
And so you couldn't, obviously.
No, you can't.
You cannot go faster than Jackie Kennedy can walk, the bereaved widow, with her two children. So there's a lot that goes into it. And in that sense, this was obviously, even though, again, everything's behind you. So in hindsight, you saw it. But mm-hmm. at the moment, you're oblivious. This mm-hmm. was the biggest, obviously, the biggest
vision.
Profession.
You definitely have tunnel vision.
So you just got to keep reining the horse back. Yeah. But you can't remember the name of your poor old horse. Boy. Just goes to show.
I don't remember his name.
No, I can't remember. Steve somebody works with me every morning. Well, this has just been my delight. Richard Pace from Canton, Missouri. I must admit that I was only 4 years old when President Kennedy passed away. And I do remember Blackjack, the riderless horse. That I remember very distinctly, watching that on television with my parents and, of course, my mother crying, mm-hmm. and I couldn't really quite understand everything that was going on. So you were a witness to history. How old were you the day of that funeral?
22.
22 years old. 22. And when did you then have to go to tours in Vietnam?
My first tour was 65, 66, 71, 72.
So you served for quite a long time in the U.S. Army.
I retired from the Army.
Okay, career Army.
83 out of Fort Carson, Colorado.
Okay, well, fantastic. Well, thank you so much for your service.
You're welcome.
And I'm sure you saw days that were not quite as nice as just riding horses around.
Nothing to write home about.
You would have rather stayed riding horses than have to go to Vietnam, I'm sure. Wouldn't we all? But we thank you for your service to our country, and we really do applaud you for the part you played in history, even though, you know, it wasn't something you had any control over. It's nice to know that the U.S. Army is prepared even today, and I'm sure that that old guard detail, which still exists, is, as we speak, there's a plan in place for any strange contingency that could possibly happen. They are ready, willing, and able to make it happen, and that's just part of being prepared for the Army. So thank you for your service.
You're welcome. Thank you.